Well, to answer the question, I've already gotten a couple times. The steak was amazing.
What about the nuggets?
I think Ethan made off with those. I saw him with the McDonald's bag. I kind of think Riley might jump in there and try to snag those. She's a big chicken nugget fan. But yeah, the steak was better than it smelled. So that's everything.
You said you beat your sermon then.
Yeah, I see. I feel like Ezekiel. And it tasted as sweet as candy. Yeah. Well, I want to look back in Hebrews. We're going to start, we'll read what I read this morning real quickly, and then we'll go on to chapter 6. But I want you to know, when you're studying for a sermon, and thankfully, like with Richard, he's doing, the same book of Matthew, and so he can pull stuff and get on it the next week. I don't necessarily have that option when I'm just filling in. So that's why these Sunday nights are so great, because you do a whole lot of studying, and there's a whole lot of stuff that you have to just call some of it. Okay, and this morning, there's a whole lot of these following verses that connect back to the verses we did this morning. And there's so much more just in that illustration of the different meals. The thoughts, Amy talked to me about, Amy Works talked to me about some that she thought of as she was leaving this morning. So, discipleship is a big thing, and that's why the writer of Hebrews is so adamant about it right here as he gets in and he writes this letter. And that's why he's so serious and in the listener's space, so to say. But let's look again at verse 11. There, about this, we have much to say, and it's hard to explain since you have become dull of hearing. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracle of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. The solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. When I was preparing for this, the two things that really jumped out to me in this passage is the two things I made my points on this morning were the word of righteousness, the fact that we need to be students of the word, and it needs to be a fresh learning. Okay? I think sometimes I've talked to people before, and you introduce different ways to look at verses or different ways to look at scripture that are not heretical, but they're just not maybe what they've always been taught, and or the way they've always been taught it. Okay. For instance, can anyone think of a scripture that someone taught you before and you're like, wait, I've never heard of it that way? One that I've actually preached on here before, and Richard talked about it when we were going through Revelation, was in the letter to Laodicea, when it talks about the hot and cold water. Okay? Most of the time when I was taught that growing up, I was taught, the cold is for the devil and hot's for God, and God would rather you be at least all the way for the devil instead of halfway in between. Did anyone else get taught to them like that? Okay. That's the way it was kind of taught to me. But then when you study the scripture and you read other people that have studied the scripture that are much smarter than us, you find out that where Laodicea was, there was one town, they were right in between two towns, and one town was known for really hot springs, and another one was really known for really cold springs. And their water, the cold springs, was useful for whatever cold water we use for drinking, for maybe preserving things or whatever. The real hot water was real useful for, health reasons and things like that. And he's saying, Laodicea, just like your water, it doesn't really have a real purpose. And you don't have a real purpose. You're not living your purpose, okay? That's what I'm talking about when I'm talking about fresh and new. talking about digging deeper to where you find out stuff that opens the scriptures up to you. And one of the ways we do that here is, is our pastor, okay, and the study he puts into all of every time he gets up to teach. But I guarantee if he was here, he would tell you, don't just trust him. You never want to just trust your pastor. Okay, you want to dig in for it yourself, because if all you believe is, well, Brother Richard says this, so that's what I believe, then that's not your faith, that's Brother Richard's faith. Okay? It needs to be our faith. And it only becomes my faith when I go and do it myself. When I go and dig into it myself and say, you know what? He's right. And then, a lot of times when we do that, he didn't have, like this morning, I didn't have time to teach on everything I wanted to say. You're going to find out things that he didn't have time to teach on because he can only get so much into the time he had up here. And so, hopefully that's just a reminder that our understanding of Scripture needs to be fresh and new. And the other thing in here was the discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. And really that connects, like I said, back to the you ought to be teachers. You ought to have people in your life that you are pouring into. That you have, and the word intentional is kind of one of those key words in church talk, intentional. But it's true, you need to have intentional conversations, intentional times. There was a book I read for youth ministry several years ago that really impacted how I did youth ministry. And that is, it's called The Be With Factor. And what it talked about was part of our job as we mentor students is to have times where you're just with them. And one of the things that it suggested in there is to let youth see you and people that you're mentoring or discipling see you in everyday life. They said like a female youth worker could just call a kid up and say, hey, I've got to go run some errands today. Would y'all maybe call a couple students and say, would y'all want to go run errands with me? Okay. Because those teenagers need to see what a Christian adult does in their everyday life, how they treat people when they walk into that place where they got to give them money or when they buy groceries or whatever. And you know, that's the same thing in any of our mentoring. And that's what Jesus did to the adults that followed him around. Well, some of the disciples were teenagers. But that's what he did with the people. They saw him in his everyday life. Okay? And just think if we just were intentional in our conversations, in our opportunities to be around people. When we're around them, that we don't just preach at them, but we try to have intentional situations to where, you know, if we go out to eat with someone and we try to just somewhere in there get in some conversation about their walk with the Lord or something, their faith, or just something you learned that week that you can impart to them, or something that you read in the Bible this week that God's done in your life. Just whatever you can do, a story of the way God affected your life in the past, whatever we can do, because when it comes down to it, it's about a life on a life, okay? I like our new Razorback football coach so far. It helps that he won yesterday. If he didn't win yesterday, I was not going to use this as an illustration. But one of the things I like about him is he's practicing discipleship as he leads those men. Okay? He's not saying that out loud in his media press conferences. But when he talked a week or so ago with the Touchdown Club in Little Rock, I listened to the recording of that, and he talked about his philosophy as a life on a life. That it's about the teammates working together and learning from each other, and those coaches impacting those students that's under you. That's what the church should be, folks. And sometimes I'm afraid more of that happens in the football locker room than it happens in the church. Because they talk about it more. And they encourage each other even more. And if they don't do it, they can make them run. Don't worry, we won't do that here. But you see what I'm saying? I think he's got it. think in the church sometimes we get so caught up in everything else we do that we forget it's about people. And it's about impacting lives of the people. And not only that, it's when we're seeing the same people all the time, does that concern us? Does it concern us when we don't see new people? Like I said this morning, to not do discipleship, to not impact others, is a sin. We want to point out a lot of other sins sometimes, but if we're just coasting through our Christian walk, we don't want to hear about that sin. Sorry, I've got a little tangent here. Chapter 6, verse 1. Therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity. And here he's going to talk a little bit about what maturity looks like, okay? Not laying a foundation of repentance from dead works into faith toward God. I want to stop there and we'll come back to verse 2. You know, in that, you know, I hit you with two things, the scripture and it's about others, and I thought those were kind of encompassing some of this other stuff. As we study scripture and as it becomes fresh and anew to us, one of the things that scripture points out is our flaws, our sins, okay? When I first took a biblical hermeneutics class at Washtenaw, one of the things they taught us to look for when we study scripture are sins to confess. Okay, as we read the scripture, we're supposed to look for things where we see, maybe whether it's in a narrative of somebody's life or it's in one of Paul's teachings, we're supposed to look for ways that we're not right with what God's call is and confess those things. Here's one of the problems, is a lot of times in our faith, we're dealing with the same sins over and over, so we don't have time for new ones to fight with. Sometimes that's what he's talking about here, laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works to faith for God. We're trying to do the same things and expecting a different result. We're not really repenting of our sin. We're not really throwing it off. We're keeping going in the same thing. And if we don't see in our life maturing to where we're not dealing with the same sin, then we need to look at something. We need to look at ourselves. If we look back and you've been a Christian for 10 years and you're still dealing with the same sin you dealt with when you first became a Christian, you're still on milk. But here's the cool part is when you can look back and you say, you know what, that's not a temptation for me anymore. Not only has God defeated that sin in my life, but I'm not even tempted by that. That's the steak dinner. That's the solid meat. And that's one of the ways we can see how we're doing in our maturity and our discipleship. Verse 2. And of instructions about washing and the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. These are probably things that were actually arguments that he's hearing about from some of these churches building. Okay? He's probably mentioning these. These don't really seem like general statements of just things. Okay? But what he's talking about here are things that don't pertain to really the gospel. They're things that you should already have figured out. They're just arguments. Okay? It's kind of the picture he's painting. There's a lot of things we can get caught up on. There's a lot of things that we can get caught up on and argue about that get in the way of us really growing in our faith. And we got to watch ourselves and make sure that we don't get caught up in those things, that we don't allow those things to get in the way to keep us from growing. Verse 3, and this we will do if God permits. For it is impossible in the case of those who have once been enlightened to have tasted the heavenly gift and have shared in the Holy Spirit and have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the powers of the age to come and then have fallen away to restore them again to repentance. since they are crucifying, once again, the Son of God to their own harm and holding up to contempt. Now, this passage is a passage that a lot of people use to argue for what?
Loss of salvation.
That you can lose your salvation. Okay? I want to look at it. I want to look at the context we're in. Okay? Because, of course, hopefully, you being a Southern Baptist, if you're here tonight, you being part of the Southern Baptist Church, you know the Bible does not teach that you can lose your salvation. We hold to that very strongly. Okay? And so how do we take this passage and look at it and say, because he says here, just to play devil's advocate here, it is impossible to restore them again to repentance, since they're crucifying again the Son of God. So what would you say? What would your response to that be? If someone said, well, there it is, it proves you can, someone can lose their salvation.
That someone can become backsliding, which is a definition which is an reference in the Bible, where you can walk away from your faith. So to say, if she does not lose her salvation, then I have to worry about it also. When the church was there, essentially, and you get not. Once you're saved, you're saved only once. You don't want to save twice.
Well, and that's, Jordan, that's what we believe. But there are the people that believe you can lose your salvation and say, well, he's talking about here that they can't come back. So this is not just a backsliding, as we would say, someone who's a Christian that gets involved in the last sin in their life, and they kind of go off, you know, sort of off the path for a while, or backslides, and then, but we would say that they can come back, okay? But the people that are saying, a lot of people would argue that this is saying they can't come back once they did that. Someone else, what do you think? Help us out here.
Well, I would say that I'm glad that you can come back.
Yeah.
Because if you weren't busy, if you couldn't come back, I probably wouldn't be here tonight. You wouldn't let me in the front door.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to understand, I guess. Like, when you read this, like, I would imagine somebody that, you know, turns away like that was never truly saved in the first place. But to see, like, you know, that they experienced the Holy Spirit and things like that, it's hard for me to.
Yeah, the sharing in the Holy Spirit does make it tough. That part does make it tough. It depends on what, if that means they're, whether they received the Holy Spirit or they shared in it as they were seeing the Holy Spirit work. Or had the Holy Spirit speak. That's where that gets tough. But you're right. It does make it tough. Dick.
Well, Travis, you think about drinking milk this morning. Example, it's like I'm content to drink the milk because I know how to drink it. I know what it tastes like. I know, you know, I've studied milk and I understand. I have courses, milkology 101, and I'm already up to the advanced course. And I know all about milk. And I'm content to be there, and I keep rolling over and over and over and over in those places that I'm not growing. And that's what he's talking about here. To go back to where you came from, and you won't go far because you just you don't understand what's going on, I guess.
I want to sort of throw some new thoughts in on the way we see salvation compared to how I think they saw it in the New Testament. Not saying we change how we get saved here, not saying anything like that. But a lot of times when in our churches, we think about it like this. A kid walks up to BBS, they fill out the card, they get saved, we get them baptized. It's all great. That's what we're supposed to do. I'm not saying anything against them. Okay? But there's no thought in our mind really of, was it real? Are they really saved? Well, they went in front of the church. They must be. Right? And that's the way we... kind of our mindset. I'm not sure when I read the scripture and especially in Paul's writings and some of these letters, that that's the way Paul and those guys saw it. I think they celebrated when people got saved. And they talked about it. They made it public by baptism, and all that, all those things are right. But I think part of it was they sat back and said that they have fruit. And they were waiting to see if the person really gave their life to Christ, if the Holy Spirit produces fruits of the Spirit in their life. They've started saying they're an apple tree now. Am I going to start seeing apples? See what I'm saying? They waited, because here's the thing. Think of the context. In the first century, Christianity was not as public as what it is here, right? It's not as open. And they had to worry if the Roman government was going to put people in their churches to find out about them and get them arrested and sent off to the Colosseum. So they wanted to know if someone's claiming Christ, are they really saved? And so they were looking for fruit in people. And if they didn't see fruit in people, then Paul talks about that salvation is a process. It's work out your salvation with fear and trembling. We get saved one time, and okay, I'm not saying when I was saved at 7 years old, and I received the Holy Spirit that day. The Holy Spirit came and spoke to me. I have no doubt about that. No doubt whatsoever. But if I was to look back on my life and the people in my life then was to look, and all of a sudden there's no fruit, then I think biblically we have every right to wonder. Now, it's between the person and God. Okay? I can't tell you if you're saved. You can't tell me if I'm saved besides by the fruit. And we don't know. There's times people get saved and they weren't mentored or discipled in any way, and they do kind of, rumble out in the weeds for a little while before they get, start showing fruit. But if we think about it that way, if we think about salvation not the way we did. Well, they walked up for and got baptized. I guess that's a done deal. Let's see. And instead, we think about it like they did. What I see from the Bible they did was, oh, good. He got baptized. That's great. Let's teach him and see what happens. Let's see if the Holy Spirit's working. Okay? Now, let's take this to the discipleship thing. If that person has been in the church and was baptized, and as it says here, shared in the Holy Spirit, they've been spoken to by the Holy Spirit, but they never really gave their life to Christ. Okay? They never really, and then someone was, they were coming to church still, though, but they were still in the milk. And there's not a sign of growth. There's not apples on the apple tree. There's just a tree. Then I think that's what the writer here in Hebrews is talking about. I think he's saying, look, they're falling away, and, they're not ready for me. And they don't have the Holy Spirit anymore. They don't have salvation. Does that make sense? Anybody have any questions about that? I know that it's not different necessarily, but I'm trying to get you in the first century Christian's mindset and the way they think about things, because we don't understand that, and it's hard to understand the scripture. Yeah.
We just make it so easy, and especially for the fact that one thing is always saved. And I'm like that. I want to see fruit. When I was a child and went to a church that, he brought me down to the altar, I was burning hell. And God showed up that day, and he protected me as a child and the things I went through and things. And praise God, he called me, But I was 32 years old before I started building a relationship with him, got in the Word, and I finished drinking the milk and started eating more, And so we just make it, I think as a church, the whole, we make it so easy because it's just comfortable.
you know, if a kid comes up here and gets, if a kid, say a child gets saved, I would say as a church, we probably do a really good job. Because with our Sunday school, we have great children's Sunday school. And with the Sunday night stuff we have going, Bible drill, they're going to get discipled. Okay? They're going to get some good things. And they're going to have people that are listening to them. And with the youth, I think we do a good job of seeing them, once they make a decision, we try to get them plugged in. And, some of them, we have some come and get saved and we never see them again. That happens. But I think sometimes with adults, it gets a little tougher because you think, well, they're an adult, they know what to do. No, they're a baby. They're a baby when it comes to faith. And part of our job, is for sure telling them about Jesus. But then part of our job as a church, too, is we have to help them understand what it means to be a Christian. Because it doesn't just happen automatically. You don't just like, all right, I got saved, I'll download all the files and I'll know what to do now. Someone needs to teach them how to study the Bible. Someone needs to teach them how to pray. Someone needs to teach them how to share the gospel. That's our job here. That's what we're here for. That's our purpose. And that's why we need to look and say, well, are we doing that? Because we want a church full of people that are ready to meet. And we have to look at ourselves individually and say, are we helping people? And that's how we can know, too. If they run away from that accountability and they run away from that wanting to grow and to work their way up that ladder, because you know what? And this is what Amy talked about this morning as she was leaving. She kind of said, you know, when you're drinking milk and you're eating that baby food, someone else is feeding you. And that's real easy, right? Someone else is squirting the milk in your mouth and putting it in your hand. Someone else is dipping that baby food out and spooning it to you. And doing the airplane and the hangar thing or whatever you got to do to eat it. Right? They don't do that for me anymore. I don't know, Tom. You should get that. But here's the thing. Once you get those nuggets, it starts getting a little tougher, right? Whatever they're made of needs to be cooked. Okay? And you got to purchase them. You got to purchase the other. It usually costs you a little more. That baby food was 58 cents a can. Okay? The nuggets were a little more than that. Steak, a little more than that. Right? And that steak, to cook good steak, takes a little work, doesn't it, Kevin? It takes a little work. If you decide to marinate, you got to do that. You got to get the right seasonings. You got to get the grill hot, or wherever you're going to fry it up, or whatever. It takes a little work. And that steak ain't cheap. So you got to do some work to even pay for it. And as it goes in our faith, it's going to take a little more work each time. Are we willing to put that work in? And I see this trouble for years in youth ministry. With kids coming out of youth ministry and the transition to adulthood is so tough. Because to be honest with you, that's the transition from the baby food to the nuggets. In a lot of churches. Because they're getting spoon-fed everything. Okay? They don't have to know how to study the Bible, really. They got someone else kind of telling them how to do that. And in children's ministry and in youth ministry, as they're growing up, all of a sudden they're in the real world. And you're in a small town like Camden where they don't have really much for your age group at churches. And so then here they are, they got to figure out how to do this themselves. That's one of the sole reasons last year for youth on Sunday night, we switched to doing a discipleship group where the youth are actually leading. And I got some, it was difficult at first, and I got some flack a little bit from some people saying, well, I don't know, we're having those kids and they're by themselves. They're 18, they can go to war. But we can't send them in a room and let them study the Bible by themselves. When they graduate, I want them to be able to open the Bible and have a Bible study with anybody they want to. And if they can't graduate and do that, then I've done a disservice to that student as their disciple or while they're here at church. The parents are their main disciple, and hopefully they're getting that from them, and a lot of our students are. But when they're here, I got a couple hours I have in a week. I want to do the best I can to raise the bar for them. So when these students head off to college, I want them to be able to start a dorm Bible study on their floor and go life on a life and impact and make disciples. And if so, there's some other kids there that grew up in a church that didn't challenge them as much and didn't push them to study the Bible and learn the Bible themselves, then they can be there to help them and hand them the milk and help them build up to where they're, well, they're in college, they're going to eat a lot of nuggets, but still, where they can eat, they can provide for themselves spiritually. They don't have to have someone spoon feed them. And I can tell you, I've been in ministry for years where I've probably spoon-fed too many people. Probably spoon-fed way too many people, because that's the way that the youth ministry was done in all the churches I've been in. I don't want that. I want more for the people that I get a chance to minister to. You know, I told you about my friend Wayne. There were times Wayne had to raise the bar on me, I guarantee you. There were times he'd pull me aside and say, "Travis, you're a leader. That ain't the way leaders act." Or, "Travis, you're a leader. You stand up and lead this part." And I didn't always want to do it. But he challenged me. And sometimes he would get me lined up, and he would put me in situations, along with my youth pastors. Once again, the guy I talked about, Wayne Harness, this morning, he was just a youth worker. He was never, you know, he was there just helping out. Most of the time, besides the short time he was youth pastor. I was thankful my youth pastors saw something in me and put me forward. But, you know, I'm talking about youth ministry, but that's what we need to be doing as a church, as a body. We need to look for things in people and put them forward. You know, sometimes, you know what, they're going to mess up. And sometimes they're going to fail. But I would much rather work through that failure with them and work through that struggle than them sitting and drinking milk all the time and having to be spoon-fed everything. I'd rather see them learn, grow, and continue in what we're talking about here. Verse 7. "For land that is drunk of rain that often falls on it produces crop useful to those, for those sake it is cultivated, and receives a blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and thistles, it is worthless, and near to being cursed, and its end is to be burned." Once again, I think this clears up the whole word of these people that have fallen away really saved. Because he's saying that the land is cultivated, and it produces fruit. Okay? He's not using the fruit motif here. This is one reason that a lot of people think that Paul did not write this book, by the way, because they figured he would use the fruit motif since he used it elsewhere. But it produces a crop, right? So if you plant a wheat field, you water the field, it's going to produce wheat. He's saying, but if you plant the field and it produces thorns and thistles, then it's going to be burned up. And when the Bible talks about something being burned up, he's not talking about the same. So, one of the reasons I wanted to complete down to this passage, especially in verse 8, "If it bears thorns and thistles, it is worthless and near being cursed, and its end is to be burned." This idea of discipleship, this idea of are we, that I have to ask myself, am I doing what I need to be doing to impact a life on a life? Do I have people in my life that I'm saying, "Come on, let's go"? I was As I was thinking about this, I got to write my article for the newsletter. I don't know if you got to read it, but I talked about being a silly goose. And I'm just looking up these, because I knew, I was thinking about it, I was trying to think of illustrations, and I was trying to think of illustrations of where people needed each other, where they had to work together to do great things. And there was three things about geese that I read that just really was amazing to me. First of all, they fly in a V, because the way the air works, the ones up front help the other ones behind, and they're able to fly farther and faster, okay? And so they do that because they're helping each other. And as they're going, the one in front will every now and then move around to the back so he can have the easy route every now and then, and someone else will move up there and lay down, okay? That's cool. Another thing is this I don't think they can prove. They can prove this part of it. The ones doing the honking noise are the ones in the back. Okay? And the person I read that was writing about this said it's almost like they're the cheerleaders cheering on and supporting the ones in the front. Come on, guys, you can go. Keep going and go strong. Okay. Y'all, that's what the Christian faith should be. That's what the church should be. You know what? There's different times different people are in the lead. There's different times, whatever setting you're in. If you're in a Sunday school class, if you're in a service on the committee, whatever it is, there's different people in the lead. But we're supposed to be working together to make it easier, go farther and farther, easier and easier. Supporting each other. And then those that aren't leading are supposed to be the ones honking and encouraging and pushing the others on as they go farther and serve. I feel like we've done that with this mission team we set out, right? We're back here and we're cheering them on, we're praying for them. I see the messages people put on Facebook encouraging them. And I know many of you have prayed for them, supported them, and because of that, we get to be a part of two young ladies coming to know Christ this morning as our pastor preached. Okay? But then also, individually, are we doing that for other people? Are we helping people in their walk and encouraging them and challenging them and pushing them farther? And at times, are we stepping in and saying, look, follow me? And then other times, stepping back and saying, you got this, go. That's what discipleship is. It's life on a life. It's us grabbing other people, saying, let's go do this. Let's charge into the fire. Let's charge into the words. Let's charge into this. And we're going to do it together. Where we put actual relationships, that we're doing it with them, encouraging each other. So, your discipleship. Well, and the last thing I want to say on that is this. Those verses, it talks about the ones that get burned up. This is an eternity issue. This is a serious issue if we're not. Not doing it well. It has people's eternity involved here. If we're not sharing our faith, there's people that are facing eternity in hell. If we're not helping others, then there's people that they need to be sharing with, that God wants them to share with, that will face that. This is a serious thing that we need to look at ourselves. See where we're at. Are we settling for milk? Are we settling to be spoon-fed baby food? Are we settling for just nuggets? Or are we sitting down the best we can and putting the work in for step? For that good meal, massage. It's not easy. It'll cost something. may cost time, may cost effort. There was times that I guarantee you, my buddy Wayne, it wasn't easy for him working with me. In fact, the first time we met, I got stuck in his canoe. It was a God thing looking back on it. Some of the paddles had gotten busted. I was a seventh grader, didn't know what I was doing in the canoe. And so he had to paddle my chubby tail down Cattern Creek, north of Conway, around lots of corners and around a bunch of snakes. It wasn't easy for him. He probably would have liked to have had someone else in that canoe that knew what they were doing. But no, it cost him something. It's going to cost us something. But I'm telling you, if you've ever eaten a good steak, it's worth every penny.